Since ISRO's successful launch of Chandrayaan 2, we have been hearing news about it getting into higher and higher Earth orbits every 2 to 3 days. Now, NASA had sent their Apollo 11 in just 4 days, but we don't have that kind of budget. So, to save money, we are using a very brilliant technique. These orbit raisings are a part of that technique. So, how exactly are we saving money? By taking a long route instead of a shortcut. Let's find out. First of all, how does an object start revolving around another? Gravity, yes, but isn't gravity known to make things fall? Why aren't these things falling? Imagine that you are throwing a rock horizontally and the earth is also pulling downwards on it, so it hits the ground in a certain amount of time. Now, even if you increase the horizontal speed, it will go further, but it will hit the ground in exact same amount of time. So the horizontal speed isn't having any effect on the time it takes to hit the ground. Now imagine that you are on a hill and you are throwing the same rock horizontally. Now when you throw the rock, as it starts going further, the ground is also curving away from it. So it will take longer to reach the ground. Throw the rock faster and it will travel even further and take longer to hit the ground. So now the horizontal speed is affecting the time it takes to reach the ground. Back to a flat ground. Now we are throwing the stone so very fast that by the time it reaches the ground still starts curving away from it. Not because we are on a hill, but because of Earth's curvature. Also notice that as the ground curves away from it, the direction of gravity also changes. So now the stone is traveling a spiral path before hitting the ground. Pause here for a moment. Do you realize that instead of increasing the speed, we can achieve the same by increasing the height? Because then it will take so long to fall that it will travel horizontally a lot before it reaches the ground. But for now, let's concentrate on speed. Increase the speed further and we will eventually reach a speed such that the rock goes around the earth completely and never hits the ground. It just continues. That is, we have put the rock in an orbit. But if the speed is reduced by even a bit, the stone will spiral in and fall down. And at this level, there is atmosphere and there are hills and there are many things to break that speed. For that, we need to go up higher, beyond the atmosphere. And as we go higher, the required horizontal speed to keep it in orbit will also get lesser and lesser. So for every height, we will get a speed such that objects thrown horizontally at that speed will get into an orbit around the Earth. So, the things that are in Earth's orbit, there is no question why they aren't falling. They are actually continuously falling, but because they also have a horizontal speed, they are never actually reaching the Earth. And the people in ISS, they are experiencing zero gravity because they are falling with the ISS. Guess what happens if we increase the speed even further? Does the rock just escape the Earth's gravitational field? Well, not so fast. See, the rock was in orbit and say we used thrusters to push it. So now it's going further away from Earth, but the Earth is continuously pulling on it. So it slows down and starts falling back. At the same time, it is traveling in this direction because that movement is not getting cancelled out very well. So as it falls, its speed ever increasing, it misses the Earth. But now it is so close by that the Earth finally manages to turn it around. But because of its speed, it misses the Earth yet again. And this loop continues. That is, now the rock is in an elliptical orbit around the Earth. Ellipse is that funny figure we used to draw in school using a divider and a thread and a pencil. So Earth's center is at one of the tips of the divider. Another interesting thing to notice is that the rock is faster when it is closer to the Earth and slower when it is further away. It's not like one orbit, one speed like we had earlier, but the distance speed product stays constant. Change that product and you are in a new orbit. Well, that didn't change much. Only if you plan it well, you'll see that aligned orbits are close by in the parts near the Earth. If you fire the thrusters around that part, we will get a much bigger orbit difference in least fuel. Small jump here and we get into an orbit that is much further on the other side. Remember, we have to fire it only to change the orbit and then the rest is free fall. just by timing our firings correctly, we get to go much further using just free fall. And we have to keep doing this routine and get into higher and higher orbits until eventually the moon's orbits are within reach. Now we could go straight to the moon by keeping our thrusters firing all the way, but that would take that much more fuel and we are saving on that fuel and hence money. Then there is this whole process of getting into the moon's orbit and then landing on it softly, which is fairly common, but more on that in a later video. Now let's just consider what can go wrong in this launch process itself. First thing, we are looking at a very simplified model. In reality, things are not so perfect. For example, we have assumed that the Earth has a uniform gravitational field, which is not the case. And it's not like Earth's gravity ends here and Moon's gravity starts here. Moon is actually in Earth's orbit, so it's in gravitational influence of the Earth. The Moon starts affecting our orbits as we keep getting closer and closer. And the Sun affects our orbits, and there are other celestial heavy bodies that affect our orbit. It's not a perfect ellipse as we assumed. There is much more complicated maths that goes into calculating the actual orbit. Solar winds, atmosphere, and many other things can affect the craft speed and hence orbit. So we need to constantly monitor it and burn the thrusters for orbit correction. This is still much less than going directly, but it needs to be done constantly. In fact, the first orbit raising maneuver was to keep the near part of the orbit as out of atmosphere as possible. In that, we had let the far part come a bit lower. Another important thing is that the timing should be perfect. We are firing when we are at the highest speeds. A small misfire and we can go into a different orbit altogether. Actually, during the launch, the orbit achieved was much higher than expected by 6,000 kilometers. Fortunately, it was in our favor. It actually reduced the further steps required, but it could have been the other way. And we had to be ready for it, fuel-wise. Then there is space debris, there can be an asteroid that has a threat of colliding into our craft. A thorough analysis of the space is done before even fixing the launch date. And in general, we are adopting a very complicated process, thus exposing ourselves to a more number of errors. So we are proceeding with utmost caution. ISRO scientists have had to estimate all these and many more possible errors before launch and had to be ready with backup plans or procedures for backup plans. Surely, this difficult task is not new for ISRO, and I wish the same success for this mission also. Let's keep following up on what happens next through the news. Thank you.